beloved Muji, is enlightenment once achieved a permanent space? Or is enlightenment once achieved a permanent space? Several times in my life, I had Satori experiences, but then misery came back. Shunyam. Come then. Thank you. Very good, Shunyam. Is enlightenment once achieved a permanent space? There's so much misunderstanding. Happens around this. We've tried to over and over again to bring clarity around this point, because everywhere in the world you go, this question is coming up, you see. Because people say, as you've continued to write, several times in my life I had Satori experiences or awakening experiences, what people say. And then after this, the mind comes back. You say misery come back. Misery and mind, same thing. The miseries come back. So what really happened then? You know? Maybe it's not the permanent state, you see? It is not the permanent space if it is the experience of the mind. It's not a permanent space if it is the experience of a person. It's not permanent, you see? It will be felt like a flash. What we call enlightenment is not for the ego, it's from the ego. Freedom from the ego, not freedom for the ego. And somehow, once achieved, is enlightenment once achieved permanent space. Once you recognize clearly, because the emphasis here is on what is your true position in the line of perception. Perception is the key term for me. Everything that appears for you, whether it's in the form of thought or objects, memory, imagination, time, anything that appears for you, requires you ultimately as the seer and the perceiver of it. You are at the root of the perceiving. Without you, there's no perception. There's no world, nothing to be seen, nothing to be recorded, nothing to be remembered, nothing to be identified. Everything hinges upon you, the perceiver of them. And I want to continue. What is there that can exist in your consciousness which you are not aware of? Everything that you feel you know, that you have tasted through the senses or through your mind, it has occurred for you. You are the taster of it. You have been the enjoyer of it. You are the perceiver of it. Even now, this conversation, these words, how far, how much they are felt or resonate inside you, you are behind even that. You are aware of that. All this you know. All these things you know. So, if you are the one who perceives them, this is my question, you are the one who perceives everything, anything. My question is, can you be perceived? You're the one who perceive. By perceiving or seeing, I mean same thing, that you're aware of it. It appears in front of you. You're the witness of it, of all these people, of time and space, of the senses, of the mind, of memory. Everything reports to you. You're the seer of it. In a sense, this is a common sense. You're the one who perceives everything. You who is the perceiver of everything, including your own body and the functions of your body and mind. That ultimate seer, can that seer be seen? Then you have to find this out. How long it will take you. Does the seer have a form? Is it male or female? Speak this for me.
I only remember when it had been happening to me, this experience of feeling myself. It's like a feeling that there is no more separation between myself and existence. It's like I went in a flowing with life, like where there are no doubts, no problems, nothing, just a melting with everything.
You know what was not there?
Yeah, I don't know.
Do you know what was not there, that this experience was so pure? You were not there as the mind. You were not there as the one who, I decide to do something, I want something, that was not there.
Yeah, finally my mind was not there.
Yes.
But
yes,
when my mind is not there, I am very happy about.
Yes. Yes. Can you see now the distinction between that you are not your mind? You are not your mind. Because when the mind is not there, I'm perfectly happy. Who is this I who is perfectly happy when mind is not there? You see, mind was not there, then perfect happiness was there. Now you say mind is here. Are you not here?
I am here, and I am, in this moment, I am mostly here with my heart. I am not much here with my mind. I am just trying to drink what is coming.
You are here, you say. Mind was not there when and I was completely happy. Now I am here and mind is here. Mind is here also. I am here also. Okay? In what way is mind interfering with you?
Oh, my mind can interfere in so many ways. And
mind cannot interfere if you, I was saying before, even the greatest salesman in the world cannot sell you if you don't buy. We feel that as soon as mind is there, it has the higher authority or the higher power. It is not true. If mind holds you with 1,000 arms, but you don't hold back, there's something powerful in that. How does mind become powerful? What you say? Mind meaning thoughts. How can thoughts become powerful? Oh, they have no power by themselves. No thought has power by itself. Thought only has power, the power it gets from you, from your belief, gives it power. Otherwise it has no power. All thoughts are equal in weightlessness. But your belief gives them strength and power. We have to be clear about this. You have to be clear about this. A thought cannot think itself. A thought cannot survive without contact with you. No thought is self-employed. It relies upon contact with your interest, your attention, and then it can grow and be something. Also, I want to say one more thing. The mind is not sentient. Do we understand what I mean by this?
No.
No. Sentient means it is not the source of the existence. It doesn't have will. Mind does not have will. There's not something like there's a mind thinking, oh, I want to make a mess of your world today. There's no such thing as this. Even this you believe, and you believe it into existence. Mind, like the moon, actually, there's a beautiful example, comparison, of mind being similar to moon and you being similar to sun. That they say the moon has no light of its own. It appears to, but it's only the reflected light from the sun. Beautiful example. Mind has no light of its own. It is carrying the reflected light from the self. But yet, because somehow, mystically, mysteriously, somehow, it appears that mind is acting independently of you. It appears mind is acting independently of you. I want you to come, and you will come, to see mind has no power. Mind has no power. Mind has the power only of belief. Mind has no power. In a way, mind is innocent. I can even say this. All its power it's deriving from you. You're supplying energy to it in the form of belief. This is why one thought for you might be so disturbing, but for somebody else it's nothing at all. So this is a proof that the thought does not have true authority. Because if the thought had true power, it would have the same power for everybody. And it doesn't. The power of the thought is in the thinker's mind. I just want to say this thing. You see? If you don't say, suppose the mind is shaking like a tree in the wind, a tsunami of thought is inside. Do you know that you can still be in total peace?
Yeah, theoretically, yes.
Does anybody know beyond theoretically? Yes. You can look around. There are a few people who know that even if mind is shaking, you can be in complete peace. How is it possible? Because for most people, mind goes boo. Yeah? But for some, mind can be whatever it wants to play, but it has no consequence upon the beingness.
No, but I was wrong. I know it also that when my mind is attacking me, I can do many things to not to listen to it.
Yeah.
I know
and it works?
Several techniques. Yes, it works.
But only as a temporary effect it works?
Well, it works in the moment. That is the only important thing. The moment.
The important how it becomes permanent is when you are clear that mind itself is illusory. We'll come to that. But you feel, oh, my mind's attacking me. That's a sort of belief also. And we believe that into existence. Your belief, the mind is attacking me, is a belief that gives further strength to the mind.
Yeah, but you feel it.
Yes.
Like if it's not only a belief of
a
thought coming.
Yes.
An attack of a thought is coming, and then perhaps one emotion is coming together because this thought reminds me something.
Try this thing. If thoughts come, like a hurricane of thoughts, and emotions come, don't say they should not come. Take this attitude. Let them come. It's perfectly okay. Who says they should not come? But don't say, this means I am not who I am. Don't say, this takes me away from the truth. Because these are powerful thoughts to add to that mischief. Say, let everything come. Let everything play. But I will just exist through my eyes in this relationship. I'll just observe. This is a very, very simple advice. It works every time. Let it happen. Let it happen. Because your struggle to try and or to prevent it actually energizes the mind even further. And if it doesn't get that type of energy, that kind of response back from you, it has nowhere else to go but to subside again into quiet. You're relating with it based upon the position of being a victim to the mind, somehow perpetuates the power that mind seems to have.
The problem arises more when, if I am in a relationship, if somebody is telling you something or something is happening in relation with somebody else, and you cannot every time say, hey, wait a minute, I check where I am, I check myself, and then I answer you. It's like...
That's not what I'm saying. That's not what I'm saying. At a certain point of your looking, even for a short, some people in the space of very short time of deeply checking in with themselves, come to a final clarity about themselves, that I am not that. And after this, they are not bothering about, oh, if the mind behaved like this or not, it's not really important. And somehow, they continue to be a sort of an inner solitude in every situation. It will be like this, in every situation. Whether you're in the city or the countryside or in the sea or you're in the mountains or you're with a lot of people or you're by yourself, it will be the same. That evenness of being. That is the purpose of this introspection. That's where it brings you. Not only a sort of like a painkiller for the moment, but an opportunity of looking steadfastly and to be totally clear until this amnesia is over. And it will be over. It happened here and it's happening in other beings. It comes to some end. The mischief comes to some end. Because none of this stuff that you're talking about was original with you from the beginning. They came after you. They're secondary. They were not original. They're not original to you. They're add-ons. They're not original with you. In the same way they can go. And if you've had experiences, some moments or some people, weeks, months even, of a period of very easy flowing consciousness, like you're walking through the Red Sea, everything is opening up in front of you effortlessly. That's also grace. You've seen that. Why should it not be continuous? You may find out. Why is it not continuous? Because somehow still when the mind comes back, it still found the I, me there. Then it could negotiate. The I, me itself also, it's not real. But you, the consciousness, develop an affection for this secondary identity, for the personality, for the idea you have of yourself. And it's the idea you have of yourself that is struggling with other ideas it has about itself. Where do we go from here?
Yeah, your words are really precious, and I will take them with me.
You know, sometimes you may, and many people here, I'm sure of it, have had very striking experiences. You call Satori, others an awakening experience. Many people have reported experiences like this. Here also I'm continually bringing you to some sober seeing. Not just explosive or emotional seeing, but very steady, conscious looking also to confirm. Whether it erupts into an emotional, an explosive seeing, or which may happen, or whether it continues to on a slow cook program of gradually seeing and burning off all this dross, you may call it, all this surface noise gets burnt off. Some people, it's experienced in a different way. They feel their whole being is on fire. And I say, lucky for you. Your being is on fire. I have no techniques to tell you now. Burn slowly away. That's fine. Others, your way is to be still very conscious, to listen attentively, to check inwardly with where you're being pointed to, and to confirm for yourself. Beautiful. It will come to an end. This struggle must come to an end. You cannot be a seeker all your life. It must, you're searching for something, then what stops you? Where is, and also what you're searching for, how much distance is it from you? So, what can be the trouble? If your real self was in the next town, then we can say, listen, you need to take this bus and then you will go there and somebody will meet you at the gate and take you in and introduce you to yourself or something. Okay? But where is this self from you even now? It will seem easier for the mind. In fact, this is what mind wants. And let me tell you, this is what the mind wants. Mind is very, very happy to be put on a kind of structure and to say, you go here and you do this, you bend 10 times, go under the bridge, climb up this mountain, sit in this cave for 3 years, drink only water and orange juice and stuff. And it loves all these things because you feel, yes, I'm doing something and I'm getting somewhere. But all of this you choose. If mind could be put in front of two choices, either the destination or the journey, it will always choose the journey. Okay? Because it is afraid of the destination, because the destination implies the end of that dualistic thinking. So sometimes this is why millions will follow a path to say, do this, do that, you know, 100 kilometers, stay here for a while, do some press-ups, go up to the next point, whatever. And this direct seeing which is pointing you, because if it is said, no, that the truth is infinite, meaning that it's everywhere present, always. So therefore it's right here where you are. Then why must you make a journey to find it? Why can't you not see that? Then we find out why. And that will save you a lot of years of going from one place to another place to pick up another kind of practice. And maybe for a while mind needs a practice. And also, even with self-inquiry, there is a practice, in fact. There's a continual checking in to check in, because the mind will always give you a position north. Go north, and then go southwest. It will always do something. So you have to check in and see, is this true? And who is the one who is witnessing these directions? Is it not myself? And confirm, until this tendency to somehow be distracted, it burns off. Simple like this. Mind will always need a map, a way. And we are all somehow seem easy to follow a path that saying, okay, now at least I know I'm on a path, now I am called this, and I'm doing this, and it will take me 3 months to do that or whatever. And then I get a certificate and I go to part two. And then it is like this. But here, in this way, you've been pointed directly. You are the truth itself that you're seeking with the assistance of the mind. And the very seeking of it also must take place also with the mind. But when it is discovered, this truth, you'll see that it's been a dream. I can't jerk you out of the dream. Sometimes you are jerked out of the dream, and seeing takes place. Maybe for a short period it happened. But also, I cannot give you constantly methods and methods and methods, because you're being worked on by grace from all sides, just by being here. You're finding that there's a reorientation of your thinking happening just through grace. There's a falling away of some superficial interest just through grace. There's an intuitive recognition of your spaciousness just through grace. It's happening also. You're bathing in grace. Sometimes it arises very powerfully to focus your attention in a direction. But that help comes through the vital force and through other energies that help you. Right now, you do this. Another moment, it takes a different form. Now everything is just accepted to be whatever it is. You're not touching anything. Everything is just whatever it is. Another moment, you feel for prayer. That's the way that your heart wants to express gratitude. You want to say, replace me with you. Another moment, you deny everything. Nothing exists. Not even this one who is saying, I want, this also doesn't exist. All these moods will come on you. Make use of all of them. They are all mirrors in which the timeless recognizes itself. So, in a way, the mind wants to learn to swim through the internet to watch a program. But to swim, you have to be in the water. And you're in the water. And somehow you're coming again to recover the recognition of your original being. We have a little time.
I am leaving tomorrow, Muji, and
it may be enough time.
Oh yeah.
The one who goes and comes actually is not really who you are, even. The coming and going happens for the body, that will happen. You are the witness of the coming and going. You are the unmoving seer of all the comings and the going. Okay, let's see.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Oh, yes. Very good. It will come to an end, this struggle. This struggle must come to an end. You cannot be a seeker all your life. It must, you're searching for something, then what stops you? Where is, and also what you're searching for, how much distance is it from you?